So welcome to the second Science and Society seminar this year. So as there are quite a few newcomers in the audience, please allow me to briefly introduce the EMBL Science and Society Initiative. We aim to promote a better and broader understanding of the growing social and cultural relevance of the life sciences. And to achieve this here at our outstation, we basically organize lectures that will hopefully get us to rethink our relationship as scientists with the society. And this rethinking is perhaps particularly crucial to us here. The EMBL prides itself in internationalism and multidisciplinary research. But how and why did these features become correlated with good scientific research? Or are these just more buzzwords that makes us more appealing to the general public? In this room, there are biologists, chemists, and physicists. And we are often encouraged to work together to develop cross-disciplinary skills. How do these become trends, and how can we survive in these demanding times? There is really no better person to address these questions than Professor Helga Nowotny. Professor Nowotny grew up in Vienna, where she studied law before pursuing a PhD in sociology at the University in the US. Since then, she has held numerous leadership roles in many international research and innovation advisory boards all over Europe, as well as teaching and research positions. Most notably, she was the co-founder of the European Research Council and was its president between 2010 and 2013. She is now the Professor Emerita of Science and Technology Studies at the ETH Zurich, Chair of the ERA Council Forum Austria, member of the Austrian Council, and Vice President of the Council for the Lina Nobel Laureate Meetings. She has also authored books and publications covering topics from coping with uncertainty to rethinking the production of knowledge. Please join me in welcoming Professor Helga Nowotny.
A warm welcome also from my side. I'm very glad that we finally managed to find a date for you to be here and for me to be here. And as you heard from Emmy, my background is in social science, but throughout my life I have been studying what you as scientists do and also the way how science functions. And through my close connection to the European research landscape, I have been able partly to put into practice what I have been researching before. And I can only say my years at the ESC were very gratifying years for me. And in some ways, it has helped me greatly in understanding also the political and bureaucratic maze that you sometimes find in Brussels and to relate to the concerns of scientists. And in the discussion, we can also speak about the ESC. But this lecture, this seminar, is about you. And it's about working together in a world that has become much more complex than it was for previous generations. Many of my generation are convinced that the pressure which is on you is much greater, but you also have many opportunities that previous generations did not have. So focusing on working together, I want to take you to essentially through sharing with whom, what, when, and why, how does collaboration work. I then want to speak about it takes time to do research, it takes time to work together. Emmy mentioned interdisciplinarity. Those of you who have actually practiced how to set up interdisciplinary teams know that it also takes time to learn to understand each other, coming from different disciplinary backgrounds. And finally, I want to speak about work and life balance. So this is just what I would like to take you through. But let's start with working together. Now, working together is the social backbone, I would say, of scientific work. Science, and you probably have heard this more often already, it's a very delicate balance between competition and cooperation. You all have to undergo peer review. This means you have to put up to criticisms by your peers, the quality of your work, the reliability, how it can be reproduced, etc., etc. And at the same time, your peers are also your competitors, because funding is scarce, positions are scarce. So, and this is a very delicate balance. This is nothing new in itself. This has existed since the very beginning of modern science. And the way how this collaboration works again shows that in science you have these two components. It's very much about what individuals do, and still it's individuals who have new ideas, who try to go against the grain, who question established wisdoms, established dogmas, and at the same time it's a very collective endeavor. Alone you can achieve nothing, but the collectivity, the teams, can do nothing without each individual also thinking and working. So again, you have this balancing, coming together, the individual point of view and the team or collective point of view. And then there are two big themes that I will not have the time to go into. Of course, working together is also a big challenge for the way how science is organized. Organizations like EMBL. It's not the only organization on the globe, so you also have this perspective here. I won't have time to go into it because, as I said, this lecture is mainly with you and for you. So let's take a look here, this first part. I want to speak about modern science and what I call the currency of recognition. Then I will move on to openness, open access, open innovation, sharing, but also the dilemmas that are coming up when you want to put into practice what policy and general working towards the common good tell us. So what about the currency of recognition? Modern science, as I said, was from the very beginning, well, you can leave it, it's just to get your minds fixed on what I say. On the left side you see the Royal Society, on the right side, this is the week, by the way, of the announcement of the Nobel Prizes. So it's very timely to begin, and I think today is physics, today or tomorrow is physics, and then the others will follow. So this Royal Society, recognition, what happened in those days? Of course, this was not the first Academy of Science, as they were called in those days. The Lincei preceded it here in Italy, but the Lincei, unfortunately, did not last very long. And the Royal Society had a kind of practice of opening up to the public, which was quite interesting in the 17th century, because they staged their experiments, and this was part of peer review in those days. You had to demonstrate in front of a qualified audience. So who was the qualified audience? For one, women were excluded. Why were women not qualified? For a very simple reason, since they were thought to be not economically independent, they were depending economically on their husbands, on their fathers, on their families, their judgment was thought not to be reliable. And also people who were dependent on others economically were excluded. So you can say it was a club of competent people, but they also had to have the economic means to be economically independent. And you wonder, you know, what this means for today, and what we can talk about it later. So what happened in those days was working together, and indeed they were presenting their work to each other, and membership in the Royal Society was highly prized. And the way how this was achieved was by valuing the contributions. Recognition in science, and I really think this is the currency that is driving the scientific enterprise. Of course, you need passion, you need curiosity, you need perseverance if something does not work. But what is really the social driver behind it is the recognition you get from your peers for the contributions you make. And here you see again the individual and the team, the community coming together. You make a contribution, but if this contribution is not accepted, you can have the brightest ideas, it will go nowhere. And this acceptance from the community has to undergo the evaluation of your peers, and once it is accepted as valuable for their own research, then you get something back, which is scientific recognition. Now, what you do with scientific recognition? You have the glory, you have the status, you may get the Nobel Prize, which, by the way, the money has been raised this year by $100,000. So there's also some funding, but very few get the Nobel Prize. So what is in it for you, you may ask, if you get scientific recognition? Well, the whole system of science, as you very much realize, has been built around scientific recognition. Whenever you apply for a grant, whenever you apply for a position, the people who interview you, the people who do the peer review, etc., they look for what you have achieved. And what you have achieved are, first of all, the publications in journals. So the recognition comes by publishing, which means, again, having been accepted as having made a contribution that is of value to the community. And this in turn, and this is where an interesting kind of cycle of recognition enters, the higher your recognition, the more easy is it for you to get funds, because people say you have done this in the past, you have been proving that you are very good, so we give you research funds. More research funds allow you to employ more PhDs and postdocs, so your output will be increased, and so it goes on. So we have a cycle, and one of my teachers at Columbia University, Robert Merton, many, many years ago, he coined this the Matthew effect in science. Matthew comes from the Bible, where it is written, to those who have, it will be given. And the Matthew effect in science means that there is a disproportionate recognition of contributions for some people, the ones who have achieved a lot. And the way how Merton arrived at this concept was that one of his collaborators did one of the first empirical studies interviewing Nobel Prize laureates, asking them, you know, how they see themselves, how they achieved, what they achieved, etc. And it turned out, once they got the Nobel Prize, they could say and do almost everything. And there was a disproportionate attention, a disproportionate credit. But it holds not only for Nobel laureate, it holds for everyone who has a long and distinguished track record. You get more than you do. Now, this is a downside, of course. What about the others? Because if you give disproportionate to some, you take disproportionately from others. And this is yet another tension that we witness in science. And this comes up in the policy discourse, especially in Europe, again and again, under the theme of inclusiveness. And also from my ESC experience, I know that, for instance, in the new member states, basically Eastern, the former Eastern European countries, there are disproportionate fewer ESC grants going to that part. And if you look at the entire world, you see where the concentration of science is. It is in the north, it's in the US, in Europe, in Japan. China is catching up very rapidly. But if you look at the rest of the world, you have a trickle here, a trickle there. So you see this Matthew effect being reproduced at various levels and scales. And inclusiveness means, wait a moment, if the principle of doing scientific work and of recognizing the contribution, shouldn't we be more careful in the way how we evaluate? We should not be taken in by our unconscious bias, and we all have some unconscious biases. And if you are asked on a panel how to judge one person who comes from a very renowned university, but the project is sort of mediocre, it's certainly not bad, but it's mediocre. And if you compare this to a person who comes from a place that you may never have heard of even, or a place where you think, well, what is it they can do there if I have not heard about it before? But who has something very interesting to say? These are the kind of dilemmas where very often the judgment, unfortunately, goes to the kind of branding that also exists in science. And I'm telling you this because you will encounter this in terms of your career, and unless we are aware that this is how we work, it's an unconscious bias, and it's much more, let's say, easier to go by the branding of the place where you come from rather than really going in depth and look at the person. We will continue to do this. So I mentioned already peer review. This is how to get there. And again, you know, as you all know, the peer review system, like democracy, has its flaws, but it's the best that we have come up so far. Nevertheless, many people have realized that the peer review system at the moment is really bursting at its seams. There are many more scientists, many more applications, many more assessments to be done, and people are too busy, and it's very stressed, the whole system. In addition, the life sciences, and especially the biomedical field, has an additional problem, because you publish much more than physics, you publish much more than chemistry and other fields, and you publish shorter articles, which is okay, but you publish much more, which means much more peer review, much more assessment. And unfortunately, and here I'm relying on the work of people like Ioannidis, who sits in Stanford. He comes from the life sciences. He has set up a big statistical center to look what is wrong with publications in the field, in the biomedical field, and in the life sciences. And he has found out many papers are irrelevant, which is a harsh judgment, no? Because you want to make a contribution. It's a harsh judgment, but you have to listen to what empirical research turns up. He also shows that many promises that are made in these published papers just turn out. He looked at the most, the highly cited papers, looking at what was promised 10, 15 years ago, and then he looked what happened, and he found a trickle of these promises having materialized. So there is a problem there, and people are aware. And one way of trying to solve it was, of course, to come up with open publications, to come up with journals like PLOS, to rely on a different way of doing it. But we are far from having solved it. Now, I mentioned openness, and I heard that in one of the previous lectures you heard about open access. It's something that you hear almost every day, open access, open innovation. And it's a very, very good idea. Why not sharing? Why not sharing and making use of what otherwise would only remain in a restricted field? But you may ask, you know, what is behind it? Why now? Why have we discovered this kind of open policy, open access policies right now? Now the answer is very simple. It's due to what happened with digitalization. We have an enormous amount of data. You are swamped, especially in the life sciences, with more and more data that are being generated. People are speaking about the digitalization of the life sciences, the datafication of medicine. So there are these enormous developments underway that come with the way how digitalization is entering not just manufacturing as industry 4.0, not just making robots that are busy in manufacturing or in the care sector or whatever. You have digitalization and automation also in science. And therefore, the idea is, if this is the case, why not share? And especially Commissioner Mördös has made this one of his policy recommendations and policy imperatives, the three O's, as he calls them, open science, open innovation, open to the world. Wonderful idea. But what does it mean in practice? Now, sharing, as I said, is a, is a good idea, and especially with the kind of, let me just give you one example of the kind of discussions that go on. If you are working in genetics, and you come up with an interesting empirical finding of your study involving a certain number of genes and their regulation. You submit your paper, it's a very good paper, you submit it to Nature, Nature accepts it, and you are happy. But then comes another group that works on something quite similar. They also have a very good outcome of their paper. They again come to Nature. Nature says, sorry, it's the quality is right, but we just published a paper in this field. Sorry. So what you do? And then comes a third group, and it's closed. So the idea and the discussion then says, well, why not open up? You share, you have larger groups, you compare your results, and your impact will be higher. So this is one of the ideas behind open access, opening up. But, but as I said, there are also some dilemmas of openness. And here I rely on an article that has been written by two colleagues of mine in the field of science technology studies, Levine and Leonelli. And they, as we work in STS, we go and speak to scientists, we look what is happening in laboratories. And so they try to find out, you know, how does the practice of sharing actually work? What are the good experiences? What are the not so good experiences? What is holding people back? And where are the dilemmas? So what they found, and they looked at the data banks, they looked at software and at biomaterials, things that are utterly familiar to you, and you work with them all the time. So what some of these dilemmas that came up was, first of all, one size does not fit all. And if you think of it, it makes a lot of sense. Sharing with one size fits for all does not work. You have to take into account, are there differences in the way how you work with sharing in databanks, with biomaterials, with software. But then again, there are some strands that are common to all. And what they say in this article is, if we just think of open and closed, this may be a bit too simplistic. Too simplistic because there's never complete openness and never complete closeness. It is situated in different situations. It depends who you are, where you work, what is your environment, what is your lab doing, etc. And for instance, if you work with transgenic mice, as you do here, or many of you do here, they found, well, you know, it all depends. If you have to produce the mice yourself because you want a specific artificial chromosome in your mice and you cannot order it from the firm that is your mouse provider, you have to think, you know, what is the right moment to share it? Because if I share everything at the wrong moment, you know, my past work is devalued and I will not have enough as a basis for my future original work. So this is one of these examples where this comes up, that one size does not fit all and you have to be much more subtle in looking at it. And in a similar way, looking at software, which is an important research tool by now, whether to have open code. Yes, everyone profits from open code, but if you if you let people use it too early, again, part of your work is being devalued. So they go through these detailed observations and analysis of what they found by talking to people who actually practice this sharing, who are all convinced that sharing is a good idea. That's not the point. The point is, you know, how do I value and assess the value of sharing with whom and when? Because there are the career imperatives, there are the ways how you have to get enough credit for yourself, going back to what I said before about recognition. Now, let's move on to the second part, which I have called the synchronization versus clashes of different temporal regimes. I've mentioned, just in the last example, the timing is very important. When to share? When are you in the time of your career? When are you in the moment of preparing your publication? But of course, we are all part of a very complex temporal landscape. And here, these are the three points I want to make. Institutions are time generators. Academic timescapes are being reshaped. And there are costs to efficiency. So time is given. We take it as a constraint and as a given. But if we think about it a bit more in depth, we discover that time is also made in the sense that there are deadlines and somebody sets a deadline. There are age limits. If you want to get a certain fellowship, very often there is a time tag attached to it. This is only for people under 35 or over 35 or whatever it is. And there are deadlines all over in terms of publications. There are times for applications, funding, positions. So if you think about it, we are in a very intricate temporal web. And where does it come from? And the point here is, these are time regimes that are generated by institutions. Institutions are time generators, and they can also transform time. And what happens, and this is important because we all feel, you know, everything is speeding up. And there is, from time to time, a counter-movement. It started, there was even a counter-movement for slow food. You may have heard of it, because we all eat too fast. So in Italy, you know, slow food is wonderful. But there's also a counter-movement that started with slow science. You know, why don't we slow down? And then everything will be better. Well, I don't think this is the solution. And it's not a solution because there are so many time generators going in the other direction, in speeding up, that you don't stand any chance if you just say, you know, I'm a fan or an adherent of the slow science movement. But what is important is to reflect a bit, where does this feeling of acceleration actually come from? We see, and now you have this wonderful new tool that is faster, cheaper, more efficient than anything you had before, CRISPR. It's faster, cheaper, more efficient. Wonderful tool. So you cannot say, you know, we slow down. You are speeding up because it's wonderful. And you can do things much faster in a much more efficient and cheaper way. So science is being advanced. But at the same time, we feel this pressure that you in particular are under. And this comes from the non-synchronization of these different time regimes. Institutions set their own timelines, another institution sets another timeline. And if you just think of you know, your mice as a model organism have a different temporal rhythm than flies, obviously, but you choose mice for various reasons, but of course working with flies is much faster in some respects. But also, if you think of your experiment, it takes time to set it up, to wait until you get the results. But the timelines of the journals and when to submit your article are different. They don't care about the lifespan of a fly or a lifespan of your mouse. They have their timelines because they are in the publishing business. And so it goes on and on, and I'm sure you have many of these experiences if you just you know, reflect on the kind of clashes that you experience yourself and that you are exposed to. And this academic time schemes here, I rely on work that my colleague in Vienna, Ulrike Feld, has been working at in the past years. The term timescapes comes from Barbara Adam, a woman named Barbara Adam. She has proposed this many years ago. And she says we should think of time like we think about space. We think about landscapes. And the landscape is, it varies, it has folds, it has an environment. It's not something linear. And the space is not a rectangular. And in a similar way, let's think about time, not something that, you know, goes from A to B in a linear chronological fashion. But let's think of it, we live in a timescape. And we live in an academic timescape where we have these pressures and these clashes that I've just mentioned before. Now, what is happening here, and again, is we have, if you think of careers, a career is something that is thought to be linear. Even the etymological root of career is something linear. You move on step to step higher up. Then I don't know where it stops. But but if we look at the actual trajectories, if we look at the actual careers of many young people, they are not that linear. And maybe they have never been that linear. And I can only tell you from my first, my personal experience, I realized, and this is a long time ago, the first time I did not have to rewrite my CV when I applied for a position. And I realized and I thought, well, something has happened now, you know, that has consolidated. And before that time, and I'm sure you do, you know this experience, you have to adjust your curriculum. You have to emphasize one part because you apply for something. You have to not marginalize, but you have to tone down something else because the institution or whatever you apply for is not so much interested in that. And then, you know, comes the moment when you say, well, that's me now, and I'm not going to, I will add to it, but I'm not going to change it because I, you know, want to get this position or that position. And therefore, I would say, you know, careers are much more non-linear. They are much more, they're also much more precarious, of course, but so, but from the outside, and this is again where institutions come in, they prefer linear careers. They don't like interruptions because it makes them suspicious. What have you been doing? You've not been devoting yourself 120% day and night to science. You've been doing something else. So, and so this is one way how the academic timescape is changing. Another one obviously has to do with the way how funding has changed. And funding has changed dramatically in the sense that now it's project funding, project, project, project. And you all have been socialized into that. You know how to work on projects. You know you have to start working on the next project before the funding is over. And this again, you know, adds to the kind of linearity in terms of adding and continuing project by project. But what does it do in terms of changing the timescape? You know, you have to think in terms of projects and not so much how can I get, you know, my own scientific questions into it, because now there's this project opportunity. And what does it do to the creativity of science, and is it good if we only, you know, move in that direction? And yeah, and the clashes that we experience, and something that gets left out here, because the pressure, once you think of time in a linear way, the pressure is much greater. This is where the acceleration, speeding up comes in. But if you think of it in timescapes, like a landscape, you discover, you ask, you know, where is the time for maturation? Maturation means growth. Maturation means to make experiences. Some of them are positive, some of them may be negative or even painful, but they are part of life. You may have failures, you're being told, accept failures, that's how it is, etc. But in order to integrate the failures into your experience, to live with them, to turn them into something from which you can learn, this takes time. This is what maturation is all about. And if we focus too much only on efficiency, there's no time for maturation. So let me now come to the third part, which is about work and life. I call them imbalances. You always hear about balances. I see many imbalances. And here the question is how to make room for others. So here let's start with something where you normally see women but I think more men should start to recognize themselves in this position. Juggling work and family is something that in academic life is not only a concern for women, it is and should be also a concern for men. We know the problems, we know them because there are still far fewer women making it in science. If you look at the figures at universities, especially in the life sciences, women in many universities are already in the majority when it comes to actual researchers and to the higher echelons of academic life. There's the leaking pipeline. And part of it, not all of it, of course, is related to shifting most of the responsibility for the family to women only. So this clearly it is a problem. It remains a problem. But again, from my experience, I have seen a lot of initiatives going on. But I would like to single out two initiatives that where the probability of success is higher. And one is mentoring. Mentoring is part of the academic career path by now. And where I've seen dual mentoring being offered, in other words, mentoring is offered to both the woman and her partner, or the man and his partner, in order to make clear in terms of your future career, you have to think of what your partner does, the attitudes, the willingness, the understanding, what it will entail to move on in your scientific career. And therefore, I think if you can, at least part of the mentoring, have dual mentoring, including the partner of the future young scientist, be it male, be it female, it's something that will help the couple to make the right kind of decisions. And they may find out in the presence of a third person, there are problems that they never talk about when they are alone, because, you know, if it's not so pleasant, you don't talk about it. Or you don't have the kind of professional guidance to tell you, have you thought about that? And this may and will turn up later on in your career. And the other more successful initiative that I have seen is whenever the top of an institution is firmly behind some kind of initiative that helps to ease this imbalance, the success rate is much higher. In other words, if the president of a university, the director of an institute says, this is on my agenda, I mean it, and I will see to it in the committees, in every aspect, down to the kindergarten that you may have to have near your workplace, etc., this is something that also has a higher probability of success. But then, apart from family, your partners making room for others. This is where we come to science and society. That is the name of this seminar, of this series, starting to make you more reflexive about it. And I wonder whether you have ever thought of a very simple question. What is the place of people in my research? Do they have a place at all? You work with mice, so there are no people. But you know, at what point in your research does society in an imaginary way enter, apart from this feeling that you have whatever we do, because we work for cancer cures, we work on something that may lead to a cure in Alzheimer. These are the very general statements. This is sort of the background noise. But if it comes to more concrete research and expected results, where is it? And we are speaking about something imaginary. I don't expect you, you know, to think of concrete people in your work, but, you know, where do people enter, if at all? And this is where the relationship between science and society comes in. Unless in science we also have some kind of understanding, you know, what is happening out there, apart from we will deliver, and this is one of the big promises, you know, we will deliver cures, we will see that there are new medicines, new therapies, etc., better understanding of everything. But, you know, what is actually happening? And I think this is something that is very important for you at least to think about it. And this is where also concepts like responsible research and innovation come in. You probably have heard of it. It started in Rome, a declaration. The European Commission has been pushing for it. But, you know, you have to break it down to something that is part of your day-to-day work. And you are used to be accountable in the sense that you have to write reports, you know that you have to submit your work for peer review, etc., etc. You have to have timesheets, perhaps, I don't know. With the ESC, we were fighting very hard against timesheets. But in the mind of the bureaucrats, timesheets were very important. So you have learned to be accountable and how to do it. But what about being responsible in the sense, if you break the word down into response and able to respond. You know, it opens up a new vision, a new direction. And then, of course, this... robot here is only a sign of what is going to come. I spoke about digitalization, and it will be part of the way how we do science, I can assure you. In some areas, you know, robots and automation does already much better than humans. In many areas of diagnostics, it has been proven again and again that machines can do better than humans. So, you know, I'm not saying your jobs will be gone, far from it, but you will have to live with this kind of other as well, and to think, what kind of stand do I take, not just to the people in my work or my relation to people, but also to this kind of other. And then, of course, this has a global dimension as well. as I said before, when I spoke about inclusiveness, we see a shift in terms of where science, good science, is being done, new initiatives. We see a shift towards Southeast Asia, in particular China. We see the percentage of publications going down for Europe and the US, not because people publish less, but because in other parts of the world more is being published. It's a trend. The numbers so far are, you may say, insignificant. I don't think they are insignificant. and this will go very, very rapidly. So we also have this to include somewhere when we think about responsibility, when we think about including others, the others in the global south. The two research, yes, science is the same, whether you do it in Beijing or whether you do it in Boston or whether you do it in Heidelberg. But nevertheless, you know, the society in which it's being done has somewhat different values. You have different ethical concerns that come up. So how do we deal with that? And I will conclude with this invitation to you. What is a good academic life? There are many different ways of having a good academic life. The There is a historian of science by the name of Steve Shapin. He wrote a book on how the ideal of what is a good scientist has changed over time. And he starts with the chemist Robert Boyle in the 17th century. And at that time, to be a good scientist meant to have virtue. People were speaking about virtue. Now, for us in the 21st century, it's very difficult to relate to this concept. What does it mean? But it was still a time Boyle was a religious good scientist. And for him, virtue was one way of relating to truth and relating to religion, but at the same time, he embraced empirical science. So this has changed dramatically over the centuries, and these are, you know, snapshots of what a good academic life might mean. But whatever you choose, and there are many more variants than I can place here, whatever you choose, we should not forget we are privileged. And I am fully convinced that in all this turbulence we have witnessed in the last immediate past, you know, many people found an attack on science occurred when Trump became president, when Brexit occurred, when experts were denigrated, that this was also an attack on science. And the March on Science that was held in many parts in Europe and in the US was one way of standing up and saying, no, we can defend ourselves, we have to defend ourselves. Because what is at stake are scientific facts, it's the voice of science, it's everything that science stands for. At the same time, and here I come back to the privilege, we are seen by what, let's call it now society, by the people who protest, by the people who vote not the way how we would vote, let's put it that way. We are seen as being part of the elites, and we are part of the elite. And this is where the privilege comes in, not because we earn a lot of money, we are not in the money business. We are in the business of doing science, of having the enormous privilege of being able to explore the natural world, of following our own research questions. And by our own, I mean individually, but also the scientific community. We have fought for, and we will have to defend, scientific autonomy, which is always relative. There cannot be an absolute autonomy. It's always relative. And all this is an enormous privilege we have. And this privilege obliges us always to think, you know, what we do, is it also in the service of society? Is it for someone's benefit? And whose benefit is it for? So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Helga Nowotny, for this talk that is full of food for thought, imbalances in our lives and work. Should we take any questions, I guess?
Yes, many questions. You open up, please.
Yeah.
So I had a question about how you conceive of mentorship.
Yes.
Because in your... when you talk, you're talking about the value of setback in the sense of the learning process.
Yeah.
Whilst I have the impression in most of our society, we think of mentorship as being mainly preventive rather than picking up pieces.
Yeah.
So I was interested in how you conceive of that mentorship should be implemented.
Well, you know, in some sense, good mentorship is a bit like good parenting. And if you if you protect the child too much, it will not be good for the child. because it will never be exposed to what will happen anyway in life. And of course, as a parent, you never want the child to be too risk-taking, because the child is not in a position to assess the harm and the risks in the way how the parent. So again, you know, it's a fine line to thread. And I think mentoring is similar in that respect, that you have to counsel, to guide people. You know, for instance, I call it the indicator game as one example. Yeah, young people know very well what you have to do to get a paper accepted. You know, there are certain norms. Nobody makes it explicit, but you know, you talk to others, you know. You know how to write an application, you talk to others. So in a way, this is streamlining you. It's mainstreaming you. It's constraining you. And so I, as a mentor, want to tell you, be more daring. You know, don't accept this as given. But at the same time, I know if they become too daring, they will not stand a chance for their paper to be accepted. So playing the indicator game is one example of many that you have to tell them, look, I cannot tell you don't play the indicator game, because, or if you decide to do, be aware of where it may lead you. If you want to take the risk, you are an adult, fine, do it. At the same time, I want to keep the spirit of, you know, sometimes I speak about competent rebels. This is what we need. We need young people who are competent, but at the same time are rebellious in spirit, you know, questioning what the establishment tells you, what your elders tell you. And so I want to keep this spirit of being a competent rebel alive. So this is my answer, and failure, of course, is part of it, helping young people to learn from their failures and seeing what did you wrong, but at the same time not saying, now I doubt myself, you know, I can never achieve anything. So trickling this feeling in self-confidence while at the same time being honest to yourself, being able to analyze, what have I actually done wrong, and where do I need to improve? Other questions?
You compared societies and science, and in science you might have fake news, or in societies you might have fake news, in science you might have fake science. You have similar problems and similar challenges. If you think about societies now, we, for example, democracy developed and people vote for their governments, and there's a certain way of controlling the system from within. And if you think about like science, do you think there might be also needs to change, you know, like the way science is done? Like, for example, if in EMBL you get a new kind of director general, it's not like the EMBL employees who are voting for it. There's more like some processes behind which are more or less transparent or intransparent. Is this maybe a thing which is causing all these issues we have in the science, you know, like, or do we need some kind of changes there? What do you think?
Yeah, well, I think science is not special from other organizations, be it a corporation, be it a government. You know, if you bury things, if you make them intransparent, and somebody finds out, you have a problem. And what it does is it undermines trust. And trust is very quickly lost, and it takes a very long time to rebuild trust. And science depends on the trust of society, perhaps more than, you know, Google or Uber or any government, because you have other mechanisms to regain it. You know, the market is short-lived, so you forget about it. You have a public relations disaster with Ryanair right now, but, you know, 1 year from now, nobody may remember, only those who were caught by not being able to go to Alicante or wherever. So, you know, but for science, this unspoken and very fragile trust of society. It's very important. And if you lose it, regaining it is enormously difficult. So everything that is seen by the public as covering up a scandal, whatever the scandal is bad. It undermines a trust. So from this point of view, I would say, yes, there are differences, but basically I think science is also held by the rules of transparency, of following up, and here, you know, we have seen it all happening in the cases of fraud, and fraud happens also in science, as we know. Research integrity is a topic that is being widely discussed. And in the case of fraud, there is the reflex that many institutions, particularly universities for different reasons, but not only universities have, saying, well, you know, we set up an internal committee that's going to look into it, and then more or less nothing happens because these are your colleagues. And it's an ingrained, you know, wish you want to protect your colleagues. And it's wrong. And, you know, also to take conflict of interests much more seriously in the ESC, you know, we had, from the very beginning, we had very strict rules of conflict of interest. And this was new to many people who came to Brussels for evaluations because it had not been practiced before. So one of our rules was if you sit in a panel and if someone is an applicant from your institution, never mind your department, never mind your collaborator, whatever, your institution, the same university, sorry, you have to leave the room and we deliberate without you. And, you know, it takes time until it sinks in, but in the end, everyone is much better off because it is clear where you have conflicts of interest, how to deal with it. And to have explicit rules is one thing, but you also have to implement them. The worst is if you have a clear rule and then it's not implemented, because then you are accused from two sides, first of all, that it happens, but also that you even have a rule, so you recognize what has happened, and you don't implement it. Other questions from this side here? Perhaps let's take a young voice from this side, and then we'll come back to you. Yes, please. Pardon? Yes, but, you know, whenever we have a problem, excuse me and forgive me, whenever we have a problem, we tend to think if only we go forward in time and if we do the right thing in schools, and we all have a wonderful idea in our head about the idea school. Only if we talk about it, how to implement it, how to realize it, it becomes much more messy. Yes, definitely. More needs to be done in schools, and we see it the earlier you start with whatever, you know, is society is being, the future society is being built from the day the baby is born. The way how the parents react to the child, the toys it gets, you know, the boy-girl divide that starts very early on. There was one shocking result that came up asking six-year-old boys and girls about their self-confidence doing certain tasks. And the six-year-old girls said, you know, I can do less than the boy. So these are shocking results, and, you know, if the earlier you start, the better. On the other hand, we have to realize schools can only achieve so much. And so I'm somewhat cautious. We should not try to overestimate what schools can do, because it's the responsibility of all of us, of parents, of toy manufacturers, of the media, of the way how institutions and society acts in general. and giving young people the confidence, but also, you know, the confidence is very important, especially moving into science, being interested in science, and getting this sense of we are also responsible for what we do, and our privilege is not just because we are like Marie Antoinette and, you know, after us, the le deluge. So, please.
So, about this implementation of globalization, there's been the G7 met in Turin, and so, as you know, I am actually delegate. Our delegation proposed a global project, IMPC, in the Grand Sasso. I wanted you to comment about that.
Well, I must admit, I've not followed it closely, and I was not involved in it. But, of course, you know, global collaborations are getting more and more important. There is a realization that each country can do only so much, and especially with the big challenges, be it energy, be it climate change, be it epidemics, be it whatever, they are global by nature. And they can only be tackled by global collaboration. Now, here I'm 100% with you, but the specific form in this, in which it happens, of course, depends also on the political will, on the strategies that be it the European Union has, be it other parts of the world have, and then we enter very difficult terrain. But I am convinced that the necessity for more global cooperation is there and it's being recognized, but we still have to take much more, many more concrete steps to do it.
Has there been any discussion in the actualization of some sort of organization? I mean, I've heard before that if you want to implement a brand new idea, in a sense of collaboration, you need a new institute or a new organization, so some sort of international body to actually come forward in some role like a diplomatic plus like climate management sort of area where you can actually bring together tools, bring together data, bring together ideas from multiple institutions. Is that, have you heard of that being discussed, like creating an actual organization, institution to meet these?
Well, it happens all the time. in the sense that there has been a surge of what is called science diplomacy. If you look it up in Google or wherever, you know, you will find more conferences, more seminars, more articles being devoted to science diplomacy. Why? The more political tensions there are, the more science diplomacy is seen as a potential way out, you know, because scientists can talk to each other, and you have projects like Sesame where Israelis and Egyptians work together in the Near East, etc. So this is attractive, but then again, you know, how far does it get actually, and what kind of projects do you set up? It's a very, very complicated matter. But the discussion is there. You also have always the question of aligning enough institutions, who will fund it. And here, one trap, if you want, and I've seen this happening in many places, you know, you get governments comparatively easy, you know, once the political will is there, to set up a joint venture, a new institution, etc., to set it up. And they're willing to fund, to put money into it. And this is one thing, and politicians like to cut ribbons, you know, it's a nice photo opportunity, and this they like. But then comes the much harder question, who is going to fund the continuation, the maintenance? Who is going to fund it over the years? And so whenever you hear about setting up a new institution, international, global institution, you know, to set it up is one thing, and then everyone withdraws and says, you know, I've given money to it. And yet, you know, the the running, the operating costs are substantial. So who is going to pay for that? And that's much more difficult. But we will see more efforts in the direction you are hinting at.
In one of your papers, you quote Claudio Sunko and his discussion of whether you should concentrate only on excellence or to what extent the structure of science depends on both excellence and something else. Would you like to comment how you see the structure of science, and do you think there is a downside to, for example, the ERC or other large international organizations concentrating in a particular way on the definition?
Well, of course, you know, I believe, and I'm not alone, that the ERC has really changed the European landscape, and that it's a very good thing. But what has happened, and this, no one was able to foresee this, you know, we use the term excellence only to make a statement that the ERC is different from the other EU funding. You know, it's a big portfolio, as you know, there are consortia, there is industry, there's all kinds of things. And we said, we are different, we have a different mission, different goal, and this is why we said only scientific excellence. It does not count where you come from, whether you are from a deprived region, et cetera, et cetera. And then this was just to say we are different because we have a different mission, not because we are better. We have a different mission. And then this became a sort of, you know, they want to monopolize excellence only, which is, in my view, it's really nonsense. And if you look at what the ESC, with its focus on excellence, has achieved, it's a number of things that no one foresaw, apart from, you know, getting now, in terms of the most highly cited publications, the Europe is now surpassing the US, thanks to ERC publications. It takes some time, so you could not realize it, but now after 10 years, we see this clearly. It has by now funded 7,000 PIs. Each PI, on average, has 5 to 6 team members, so we have something like 50,000 people coming from all over the world. It's very international. We did the stats. And these people work under very good conditions, so it will change Europe, but also the way how Europe is seen in other parts of the world. Then it has done some unexpected things in European universities, which again was not part of the purpose. And what has happened by the mere fact that universities for the first time in Europe are competing in Europe and not just in one country. All of a sudden you have rectors and presidents becoming interested, where are my good young people? You know, let's find them, let's promote them, let's encourage them, let's give them the kind of support to go for an ESC report, which, you know, is what a university should do. And it also has led towards a flatter hierarchy. And being here in Italy, I can say this in public also. You know, before the ESC, there was a small possibility by the Association of European Funding Agencies. And I know a number of people in Italy who did not succeed there, you know why, and who succeeded with an ERC. So it also has changed here the way how you assess excellence. And now ESC grantees in Italy are given a position at the university, which again changes the way how universities work. So these are, you know, a number of these, if you want, unforeseen consequences that happen from excellence only. And also the proof of concept has been widely accepted. And it's not because we wanted to promote innovation. We just said it's in the nature of frontier research. You know, there are good ideas that come up, so let one of these young people take the idea and run with it. Help them to set up a startup business or whatever. So, you know, I believe in the relevance of excellence.
Thank you, Professor Nowotny again.